They come out with a flimsy excuse by saying it's the fabric of the union, the law. We know. We've been outside the law for 12 months. The law says we must cross the picket line. We didn't cross the picket line.
You don't know how I feel when I'm lying in bed at night wondering where tomorrow's dinner's coming from. And you don't know how it feels when your son tells you to sell his bike so you can pay the electricity bill.
This is Steve Zeltzer with Labor Fest in San Francisco, and I want to welcome all of you to this important panel that we're going to be having today, this international panel on the new book that's been written by Mike Carden on Liverpool Dockers. I wanted to talk about Labor Fest. Labor Fest started in 1994 to commemorate the San Francisco General Strike of 1934, the West Coast Maritime Strike and San Francisco General Strike led by the ILA and now ILWU. And we organized this because the history of working people and is important, critical for labor and for all people. And we wanted to also contain in Labor Fest the struggles of workers, not just in San Francisco, but around the world. And we see this as an international working class festival. We have films, we have presentations. And one of the things about the strike, the ILWU, is that it got support around the world, and the ILWU got support around the world for their struggle. So the other thing about Labor Fest is we have sought to use the internet as a way of building internationalism. And the struggle here for the Liverpool Dockers was connected. I actually found out about it on the internet and told Jack about it, and he was going to be going to the ITF conference in England, UK, and decided to visit Liverpool, which has helped change history, actually. So we believe that we should use these tools. The capitalists use them to attack the working class and to propagandize the working class, but working people should really use these tools to build solidarity and education. And we have a great opportunity today to do that. And we also are going to be having some other events on this coming Sunday. We're going to be having a panel on the struggle against contract labor and the lessons of the fight against apartheid in South Africa and Namibia. And you're all welcome to participate in that as well. If you go to laborfest.net, you can check out some of the events. And many of the events are on Zoom, again, which allow people from around the world to participate. Without further ado, I'll introduce Jack Heyman, who I've worked with for decades, actually, on internationalism and solidarity with the Longshoremen, ILWU, Local 10, and he's going to be introducing our guests. So welcome, Jack.
So we're beginning this evening's program, or I guess it's morning in California. In Europe, it's evening. We'll begin the program with Mike Carden's son, John Carden, who helped Mike finish the manuscript while Mike was in the hospital with stage 4 lung cancer. And it's thanks to John that the finished product was done and it's been posthumously published. So John, I don't know if you want to talk about your relationship with the Labor Party or not, but I'll just leave it at that. And thanks for being on the panel, John.
Thanks, Jack, so much. And thanks, Steve and Jack, for organizing this and inviting me to take part. It's been a massive privilege, really, working on Mike's book, because he, you know, all throughout his life, he's a very principled man. I think everyone who knew Mike just saw that in big ways and small ways, kind of very understated in his way. And in terms of the dock strike, it's interesting to hear about Namibia. You know, many years before the dock strike, Mike was involved in action to stop uranium from Namibia being passed through the ports of Liverpool and things like that. So it's throughout his life. And later on, after the docks, he worked in school meals. So he was very interested in the idea of young people at school getting healthy food that was cooked from scratch, rather than kind of paying big corporates a lot of money to provide, you know, food that doesn't taste of anything and has very little nutritional content. In terms of writing the book, Mike, he was, I think, uniquely placed to do this. Now, it's not because he left school with a load of qualifications. When Mike left school aged 15, he was thrown out for standing up to his the headmaster of a notoriously brutal school. So he left with nothing for fighting back, which kind of perhaps set the course for many other parts of his life. He was probably bright, but that the conditions that he was in at the school didn't kind of foster his any opportunity for him to kind of learn in that way. And it was through his trade union. So back then it was the TNG that he was introduced to education in a way that mattered to him, in a way that was relevant to his life as a worker. Now, he went on to get an Open University degree. So in the UK, this was, I think the Open University has been going since about the 60s, or maybe it's the late 60s, early 70s. And this was a way for ordinary people to do distance learning, part-time learning, and gain a degree. So he got a BA, a bachelor, a master's, and he was working towards a doctoral thesis as well. So he got this education, but he didn't use that to get off the docks. You know, many people saw education as a route out of their circumstance. Mike wanted to remain on the docks and put, you know, this privilege that he'd had of being able to get an education, put that to the service of his class, of the people that he worked with. So he kept, you know, he was interested in the world, in philosophy, and in all what was going on all over the globe in terms of the docks. He was involved in many of the strikes and held, I believe, every elected position within the trade union. Although he never went on, never wanted to be a paid official, because he didn't think it was right that someone should be in post too long, and he believed strongly in accountability. And in terms of writing the book, Mike kept a wealth of every document that he thought might be interesting or useful, he kept. So in the attic in our house in Liverpool, there's just boxes and boxes. Some posters, two whole boxes full of posters, all sorts of pamphlets, meeting minutes, account things like the union's accounting. You know, the TNG quarterly report or annual report and things like that. So he just kept all of it, and as well as his own diaries. And I know other people like Kevin Robinson, who's here as well, another person who meticulously kept diaries, especially throughout the dispute. And it's from these records that Mike has written this history. So he's, you know, he worked, he was uniquely placed to do it, but he didn't do it alone. He did it in collaboration with a number of people who are on the panel today. So the diaries and such of people like Kevin Robinson, in consultation with people like Doreen McNally, Tony Nelson, Greg Dropkin, and many others, and documented that history. Now, it took him about 12 years to write. He'd finished a first draft of it just before the pandemic. And the original plan was to launch the book, I think around February 2020, sometime around then. And the pandemic struck and everything sort of ground to a halt. It's probably good that it did, because the original manuscript was a million words long, and it would have been pretty impenetrable. It would have sat on maybe a university bookshelf and been an important record. And actually, people who can comment better on this are people probably like Doreen, who's on the panel, because Doreen's read about at least two, probably three or four versions of the book, and has helped Mike to edit it down. Just in terms of drawing this to a close, sorry Jack, I've gone on for too long already. The book was written over the course of about 12 years. It's been heavily edited in the last 2 years of Mike's life, and it's beautifully written. It reads very poetically. The other thing that Mike has left behind is hundreds, if not thousands, of books. He read everything from kind of lots of historical books, French Revolution, E.P. Thompson, Making for the Working Class, through to, you know, Charles Dickens and a lot of the classics as well. So really, really well read. And this book is, you know, in some ways is testament to that breadth of his interest in the world and breadth of his knowledge and experience from reading. And Mike asked me to help him. It was when he was undergoing treatment. So he was diagnosed with lung cancer in February, February of last year. And he'd edited most of the book, but we were down to the final sort of four or five major chapters. And just the task, the cognitive task of trying to edit this massive book, he needed some help with, because he was tired from the cancer treatment. And it was in many ways a massive privilege to work with Mike and to see a side of him that was, it's very personal, very intimate, how someone creates the creative process and his confidence with it. He'd been working for such a long time on the book. His confidence with his writing approach was phenomenal. He just wanted to kind of get it on the page and then would edit it down afterwards. He was fearless. You know, people talk about writer's block. He didn't have that. he'd write it down and he'd work with it a bit like a sculptor perhaps. And so I helped Mike with that, and he didn't need much help. It wasn't exactly. I certainly can't take any credit for the quality of the book, but it was more just functional stuff, like the length of the chapters and trying to help him get through that. Since Mike passed away in December, this has basically been the main project in my life for the last 6 months. Because even though the manuscript was there, to get proofreading it, editing it so it's publishable and all the rest of it has just been a humongous and primarily administrative job. But it's beautiful. Like, I can't, as a way of grieving for the loss of this wonderful man, what better way than to be able to get lost in his words and a history that I grew up through, but can see now from a different perspective. So I'm immensely grateful to be able to do that. And it's a real privilege to be here representing Mike today. And I'll stop there.
John, that was a wonderful presentation. I don't remember if Steve announced that there'll be a discussion period afterwards. So people have 3 minutes to speak at raise points or ask questions. So Mike's other son, Dan, was actually, as a 10-year-old, leading some of the demonstrations for the Liverpool Dockers, chanting, "The Dockers United will never be defeated." And he's now elected to the Parliament on the Labour Party ticket from Liverpool Walton, I believe it's called. He won with 85% of the vote. And I think that's partly due to Mike's contribution to the labor movement, particularly the Dockers struggles. He was very well known in Liverpool. And I want to thank Mary, his wife, for being on board with this program as well. So our next speaker is going to be our book reviewer, Greg Dropkin. Greg was the webmaster for the Liverpool Dockers during the entire dispute. And he, perhaps more than anyone else, knows so many of the details that Mike was aware of. And so I also wanted to credit Greg with participating in important parts of the struggle. He wasn't just a webmaster. And he came up with the proposal for the International Longshore and Workers Union, Warehousemen's Union on the West Coast, to actually hit a ship, to strike against the ship from the UK, that from the port of Thamesport, which was run by the same company that had fired the Liverpool dock workers. And so I'm sure you'll go into the Neptune Jade struggle, because that's the ship that we hit in Oakland. And without further ado, I want to introduce Greg Dropkin.
Thanks very much, Jack. I've got a lot to say, so I apologize. I want to read it rather than just talking. To start with, as John was saying, it was a great privilege to know Mike And my experience in reading the book is it actually feels like he's in the room and you just want to ask him something. Even while you're aware you're missing him, he's just so there when you're reading it. So it's a very strange experience. Anyway, we've all seen pamphlets announcing the lessons of some struggle, which the author apparently knew all about before it even happened, where all the facts fit and those that don't are omitted. This book is the opposite. Mike goes at the living history from many sides, using his own diaries from the 1980s onwards, Kevin Robinson's diaries, recordings of mass meetings, documents of the Transport and General Workers Union, and the official conference video, a parliamentary committee, interviews with Dockers and women of the waterfront, films, videos, and Labournet. He tells the story in all its complexity and contradictions, which means that you can learn from it. And I'm sure Mike learned from it while he was writing it. So I'm just going to touch on some of what he covers. Union collaboration with the Mersey Docks and Harbor Company, the MDHC, began decades before the refusal to cross a picket line triggered the 1995 dispute. 2 years earlier, the company had agreed not to bar shop stewards, but fresh elections must take place and stewards would have to sign a joint MDHC-TGWU accreditation form, but the members would not see this. More than 100 TGWU members boycotted this election, but it did not stop the union from declaring a result. MDHC had paid for the postage of the union ballot papers, which were also issued to workers who were not even members of the union. Some were not members of any union. Against union advice, the Dockers held their own workplace secret ballot. Later, a majority took part in a postal ballot as demanded by the company. Mike Carden and Billy Duffy were both included on the ballot paper, but with an asterisk against their names and the notation that a vote for either candidate was a wasted vote because of their refusal to sign the accreditation document. They would not be recognized by either the union or the employer. The union official kept the returned postal ballot papers in a plastic shopping bag. The point to all of this was to neuter the union, and as a result, work at Seaforth Container Terminal was now rigidly controlled. Shifts would be 12 hours long, starting and finishing at MDHC's convenience, with disciplinary action taken against anyone who failed to respond to an instruction or an order to attend work. Liverpool Dockers were reduced to being prisoners in their own homes, which became the new pens and hiring halls for recasualized labor. In September 1995, young Dockers in a separate company, Torside, were summarily dismissed in an overtime dispute, which led them to put up a picket line at Seaforth. Most Dockers refused to cross and were immediately sacked, which unleashed fury and a combined challenge to the company and the union. The detailed timeline in the book shows what the union docks officer did and didn't do, what the stewards did, including Mike's own role. Much later, it emerged that the Torside boss had been prepared to reinstate his workforce, but the union officer failed to inform any Dockers of this offer. In other words, these particular sackings could have been avoided, but the big dispute was coming anyway. The book recounts the explosion of activity by Dockers, their wives and partners who took the fight across Britain and internationally, trying anything they could think of and bypassing the refusal of their union to call for, let alone organize, industrial solidarity action to compel reinstatement. I want to jump 2 years ahead. The union held its biennial delegate conference in July 1997. The BDC was the supreme policy-making body to which the executive and the general secretary, Bill Morris, were accountable in theory. The general executive council was controlled by the broad left. The executive drafted a statement on the dispute which sought to remove 9 properly submitted formal motions from the conference agenda and replace them with an endorsement of the union leadership strategy and an attack on media coverage which had criticized the union. The dock stewards tried to get the statement withdrawn before conference. At the BDC, Belfast Dockers, lorry drivers, the convener of the Rover Cowley plant, the leader of the civil aviation transport section at London Heathrow, and many others demanded that the executive withdraw their divisive statement and allow debate. Several of these speakers demanded industrial action. Dave Irvine, a delegate from Northwest Region, addressed Bill Morris directly from the floor. How on earth, General Secretary, can we support the right to take solidarity action, the right to effective picketing, the right to freedom of association and then cut loose 500 Liverpool people for 22 months. Whatever these Dockers want, this conference should deliver and the TNG should deliver. The union's Deputy General Secretary, Jack Adams, led the negotiations with the company and was seen by the stewards as their only friend in the leadership. At conference, Adams introduced the statement as a product of the General Executive Council's responsibility, quote, to preserve the fabric of the union and operate within the constraints of the law, unquote. Adams accused the Dockers of demanding the TUC call a general strike, which in fact they hadn't. From the gallery, Dock Steward Secretary Jimmy Davis called out, don't mislead conference. Mike quotes the Steward's chair, Jimmy Nolan, at length and speaker after speaker replying to Adams. Here's one, Penny Iverson. Despite the inaction of the leaders of our union, an injury to one is an injury to all. The Dockers are showing us how to preserve the fabric of a working class union against vicious bosses. What is a union? Is it the cash? No. Is it the buildings? No. A union is the members and the will to organize and fight. And if you have that, the money will follow. You lose, if you don't, you lose the money anyway. You lose the money because you lose your membership because they will see you won't fight for them. Don't accept this statement. Now, to everyone's surprise, conference actually overturned the executive statement. But then, in the midst of this cheering multitude, the chair declared that the statement had been passed. Most delegates refused to leave the hall, and after several minutes of wild uncertainty, the chair announced a card vote would be taken in the morning. And when it was, the statement was eventually rejected, 283 to 182. But for the General Executive Council, nothing changed. At their meeting in December after the BDC, the chair, the same chair who had chaired in the conference, ruled out all motions on the Liverpool dispute. One of them from Region 3, Ireland, called for the General Executive Council to immediately invoke the unqualified support of the International Transport Workers Federation, that's the ITF, in support of our sacked Liverpool Dockers, unquote. Mike Carden told the exec, the union is using the position of the chair to undermine supporters of the Liverpool Dockers on the GEC, who would need a clear two-thirds majority under rule to reject or defeat his ruling. Carden's challenge to the chair's ruling was supported by only 7 of the 30-strong exec controlled by the broad left. Now, Jack will talk about the ITF, but I want to tell the Neptune Jade story that he referred to. There was no direct trade with Oakland. But in 1997, we finally found the connection. Shipping giant Hapag-Lloyd had a Liverpool office and a slot sharing arrangement with Atlantic Container Line, so their containers could go on the ACL ships. But they also ran their own service from Thamesport to the US. The Mersey Docks and Harbor Company 100% owned Medway Ports, which acted as port authority for Thamesport, whose trade contributed to Medway Ports' profits. On the second anniversary of the lockout, the Neptune Jade called in Oakland on the Hapag-Lloyd run. The Inland Boatmen's Union, Sailors Union of the Pacific, International Longshore and Warehouse Union, ILWU, Locals 6, 10, and 13, the Operating Engineers, Local 3, the International Brotherhood, the International Brotherhood of Electrical Workers, IBEW, the Berkeley and San Francisco IWW, and various supporters shut down the terminal repeatedly. An employer's injunction limited the number of pickets, only for an even larger group to turn up to persuade truckers and ILWU longshore workers not to cross the picket lines. And then, in a McCarthy-era script, the authorities demanded longshore workers identify the person or persons who first communicated to them the idea of holding a demonstration at a North Carolina port with any connections to dock workers in Liverpool. The person who first communicated the idea of holding a demonstration over the Neptune Jade, and every person who was a member of or in any way affiliated with the Committee for Victory to the Liverpool Dockers. Unable to unload on the US West Coast, the Neptune Jade sailed to Vancouver, where she was met by another picket, and then crossed the Pacific to yet another picket in Yokohama. It was only in the non-unionized port of Kaohsiung, Taiwan, that she was finally worked. Robert Erminger, who's on this call, the Port of Oakland picket captain was tried for contempt of court and could have been jailed, and the dock and shipping industries sought damages running into millions. Robert was eventually given a $100 fine and 2 days community service. Some comrades regarded the international campaign as a diversion from the class struggle at home, and that debate took place in public, as almost the entire left remained welcome in the mass meetings. Socialist Workers Party academics Michael Lavalette and Jane Kennedy had published a book, Solidarity on the Waterfront. They argued that the strike committee reflects some of the elements of trade union new realism and share the view not held by all of their trade union supporters that the law has effectively shackled trade unionists in Britain from providing secondary action. Instead of going out and trying to win and activate this campaign in Liverpool, the Dockers have returned to the international arena. Why? Because of their collective political outlook. And this includes the fact that the international campaign doesn't force direct confrontation with the TNG leadership. This is the SWP speaking. Thus, the international campaign reflects the Steward's pessimism at what it is possible to achieve at home, unquote. Well, the factual errors in political perspective were refuted online by Bill Hunter, Mike Carden, and me. Bill's detailed and savage response included, "This only shows how you can exist in the middle of a living conflict and not know what is going on," unquote. Mike concluded, "The thought that Liverpool Dockers leaders like Jimmy Nolan and Jimmy Davis who had stood up to Chilean and South African dictators blockaded uranium from Namibia. In 1972, they struck and forced the Tory government to release five London Dockers imprisoned in Pentonville Jail. And they organized a strike for the miners in 1984 that lasted for 2 weeks. The list could go on. That these men would be fearful of the leadership of the TGWU or be reluctant to call upon other workers to support their current struggle in 1995 was hardly imaginable." Now, when Jimmy Davis addressed the huge first anniversary rally in 1996, he declared the Dockers were now demanding the physical support of the entire trade union movement. Doreen McNally was also explicit, "We want industrial action." The international campaign itself was a confrontation with the leadership of the TNG, as I've indicated, but there were unanswered questions. Soon after the dispute ended, when feelings were still raw, I interviewed SAC Dockers, and Mike quotes from these interviews. Frank Carberry was one of those interviewed, and he said in the book, "The strategy that was adopted was correct, but there were certain things that weren't adopted that should have gone along with it. Maybe our attitude to the TNG was wrong. I think we should have faced up to the fact that Morris and the executive were our enemies, and we needed to confront them much earlier on in the dispute, which we never did because of the money they were putting into the fund or whatever, for whatever reasons. But I think that was a mistake. Maybe we should have occupied Transport House in London, as some of the lads suggested. We should definitely have taken more direct action to confront Morris. It was winnable at certain points. Right at the beginning, I think the Torside lads should have been invited to come in and occupy the gantries. We should have stayed inside the port. I mean, it was no secret. We'd known for a long time that the dock company were out to get us. And a lot of the lads had said there was no way we could fight a dispute outside the gate. We had to fight it from inside. But once the picket was set up, it just had a momentum, a life of its own. We should have tried an occupation then as well." Well, Frank goes further, and I hope people will read his interview in full along with the others from February 1998. "As an elected member of the General Executive Council, Mike took it very hard that the broad left refused to authorize using the union's power in defense of Liverpool. How could this be overcome?" Mike quotes Jim Dye, an activist in the Public and Commercial Services Union, PCSU. "At the end of the dispute, Dye advocated a rank and file based left grouping that combines the best elements of the old broad left with an open democratic structure. While the winning of union positions was essential, this could only successfully be achieved by placing the rank and file at the center of activity and outlook in order to make any newly elected, left leadership accountable." Mike wasn't hostile to Jim Dye, but he saw the problem is much deeper. And he wrote, "Dock laborers were never opposed to the principles of trade unionism. They were opposed to the union's bureaucracy, who saw a rank and file organization in the union and on the waterfront as a threat to the unelected power of paid officials. The failure of the TGWU to support the Liverpool Dockers was not the responsibility of one union official or one general secretary. As a democratic organization, it was the responsibility of the membership." Now, I think that's right. Liverpool Dockers were exceptionally well-informed about their own situation. They expected accountability and they got it through the mass meetings. They had a history of supporting other workers in struggle and their horizon grew with the dispute. If that perspective had been replicated around the country with members throughout the union, knowing each other's situation as well as their own and demanding accountability, there would be much less room for betrayal. But if members just focus on their own workplace and delegate responsibility upwards, those who have been given power are out of control, whether they start off on the left or not. In other words, democracy starts from below, and it's hard work keeping it alive.
Thank you, Greg. We appreciated your input, your analysis on Mike's book. And I was remiss in mentioning that John had done a short video on Mike and the Liverpool Dockers struggle. So John, do you have that video? Can we run it now?
So this video was made by Elizabeth Marliangez, Xavier Cano, and Danielle Sultan. And they were all involved in, Elizabeth and Xavier were involved in the Ken Loach film, The Flickering Flame. So they were kind of, they were the French partners sharing that, distributing that film across France. And Danielle Sultan made a wonderful, very personal film about the Dockers and the dispute. So it's using some extracts from that. And so I'm very grateful to them for creating that bulge.
The address on the dock situation is going to be left till the end of the week.
Right-wing organizations that supported openly the abolition of the scheme, they were publicly saying it wasn't just about the terms and conditions of employment. It wasn't about pension schemes. It wasn't about just reducing wages. It wasn't just about introducing casual labor. It was about eradicating, doing away with the culture of dock workers, this culture that we all share in this room. They wanted to eradicate that culture and introduce a new culture to dock work that accepted the authority of the employer. A culture that accepted you do this and you do this for this amount of pay. You do it for this amount of hours, for 12 hours, for 14 hours. And when you finish that, you'll do something else. And when we don't need you on Monday, you go home with no pay, and we'll call you back on Thursday, and we'll pay you whatever we decide to pay. So obviously the threat is there for all of us.
The history of dock workers throughout the world, I think, to have that sense of independence, because it's difficult, I find it difficult to explain, but it's different from a factory. It's different from factory work. And it's very like coal mining, it's very like seafarers, because when dockers go to work, they work in a geographical area of the river, and it's separated from the community. Normally there's a wall around it, because of the it's a brutal environment, it's a hard environment, and perhaps like old-fashioned expressions like it's macho, it's a, you know, and there's that sense of it, there's that sense of it's a dangerous environment like this, and the employers and the union work together to discipline, because it was a harsh environment and a difficult industry to discipline. Because when you think, when a worker goes to a factory and he works on the assembly line, making a car perhaps, then the work disciplines the worker, you know, makes the cars. The work has to keep up, like Charlie Chaplin, he has to keep up the machine. Yeah. Whereas the dock worker, he goes on board a ship and there's a hatch with cargo in it, and the cargo is generally difficult to release from underneath the stowage points, and it needs to be manhandled out, or a crane has to pull it out, and it can take, you know, 4 hours to move one big crate perhaps. So it's like stupid to be saying to a docker, you work faster, you... It's not that type of industry.
The Dockers' history, it's like bits of information. There's a couple of wonderful books, but there's no entirety to it, you know. And it's like a crime scene. It's only when you put it all together that you realize the fucking criminality of what went on. Yeah.
We're back. Thank you for that, John. I think you better get in touch with Ken Loach right away. I think he's got a position for you. That was well done, well done. To follow up on what Greg had to say on the Neptune Jade, there was one really important point that was not made, and that is the ILWU was sued under the Taft-Hartley Act for its solidarity action around the Neptune Jade. And the way we beat it was the editor of the Dispatcher, the union's newspaper, asked for all the faxes, meeting minutes, council meetings, anything that had to do with Liverpool to be put in his office, the office of our newspaper, and we claim freedom of the press, that those documents could not be seen in court or anywhere else if we didn't want it. And we won that. The judge ruled in our favor. And this is sort of a paradigm for other unions that come up against these anti-labor laws. Taft-Hartley was probably the worst, and it was passed in the midst of the McCarthy period by a pocket veto by Truman, the Democratic president. So our next speaker is going to be Doreen McNally. Doreen was the head of the Women of the Waterfront. If any of you have ever seen The Salt of the Earth, that was made by one of Hollywood 10 screenwriters about a hunger strike in New Mexico, I believe it was. And when the men who were the miners were served with an injunction similar to Taft-Hartley, that they couldn't picket, the women took the place of the men on the picket line. That's what Salt of the Earth is about. And that's very much Doreen McNally is about. That's what motivated to different countries. They came to Oakland, California. My partner who's here this afternoon or evening, met the Women of the Waterfront. Michael, thank you for coming on board. So Maureen played a central role in this struggle. And with that, I called her a firebrand, and I think she really is.
Whose side are you on?
We'll go down to Blackpool to lobby the TUC. Because as you know, we've been a year in dispute. And all men, some of them have paid their union dues for 42, 43 years. And they should be supporting us. That's what trade unionism's all about.
Thank you very much. No, we've had enough. I'm sorry.
No, he hasn't got the anti-trade union laws. That's my government going to come in office, and he hasn't told me whether he's going to repeal the anti-trade union laws.
Thank you very much.
No one can speak on our behalf. Sure. You don't know how I feel when I'm lying in bed at night wondering where tomorrow's going to show. And you don't know how it feels when your son tells you to sell his bike so you can pay the electricity bill.
They come out with a flimsy excuse by saying it's the fabric of the union, the law. We know. We've been outside the law for 12 months. The law says we must cross the picket line. We didn't cross the picket line.
What I'm saying to you is, don't insult the intelligence of the working class.
Liverpool listening to it, it brings all the memories back, all, as though it happened yesterday. The women became involved. This was the first time women had ever been involved in the docks disputes, because it was a very macho industry. There was rarely a picket line up in previous disputes. It would come over on the radio, the docks were on strike, and nobody went into work, as simple as that, and then the radio would announce when it was over. After the miners' dispute, we started to realise, well, we knew with Margaret Thatcher what was going on, and you could see what was happening. It was on the cards that every industry was going to be under threat, the miners, steel, and she was obviously going to come for the dockers because they were as powerful as the miners and as the steel men used to be. When the dispute happened, and those Torside men put the picket line up, and the men didn't cross the picket line, that wasn't the whole story, because the port of Liverpool at that time was a time bomb waiting to explode, waiting to go off, because the men and their families had been under so much pressure because of the treatment from the dock company, ringing home, treating wives and children as though they were secretaries and had to pass on messages for the dock company. They intruded to an unacceptable level in our family lives. So when this, it was a bit perverse how I felt, because when Charlie came home and said what had happened, you sort of felt perversely relieved because you'd wanted to take them on for so long. And the men were waiting for the right moment, because it's always been, it's better to fight from within the port than outside of it. And then when the women were asked to come to a meeting by Kevin, you realise then this was something very, very different, that we were being invited along. And I don't think that without the women being involved, and it gave a sort of, you felt as though you had some control over your situation. You could support your husband because you were totally aware of what went on. You knew everything that was going on, and there was no, he wasn't trying to protect you because you knew from your own meetings what was happening and what wasn't. Everyone understood, and if you didn't, it was easy to find out, you know, from someone what was going on and what was happening. The women brought a new dimension, and I don't think the dispute could have lasted the 2.5 years without their support, principally because of their involvement, and because they knew what was going on, they wanted to fight and support their husbands and families. We politicised our children. We had children coming on the picket line, and Colin Mitchell, for instance, he was, well, 8 or 9 years old, come on the picket line and saying, hey, everybody, Mersey Dock shares are down 2 points. That's £2 million off their shareholdings. Even the children were given this political education, and the whole thing was a learning curve. Throughout the dispute as well, we also gave support to other people, the women of Srebrenica, the Tuzla miners, things throughout the world that were going on, we gave support to. We weren't just taking support from others, we were doing our share and giving back, as and when we could and how we could. Over the, there were two Christmases, three Christmases, which is a very, very difficult time, especially when you have young children. And the support from around the world, from other trade unions, was absolutely incredible. But all the time, it's not till you look at something like this today And you see it all at once, how vast the betrayal was, because during the dispute, it was drip fed, because this happened today, something else happened next week, the whatever. And because there was so much going on and everyone was so busy and dealing with so much, because you still had the inevitability and eventualities of life, as well as the dispute. And people were, when you see it all like this, and when you read it in Mike's book, the size of the betrayal, I'll tell you what, in the right hands, there's a massive blockbuster of a film here. Because of the betrayals, because of the innovation and the organisational skills of all the men involved, the Dockers, the internationalism, and people think of it as a, you know, the Dockers were defeated. Well, we weren't, and the IDC is testament to this, because the IDC is what came out of the Liverpool Docks dispute. And the dispute wasn't just about jobs, it was against deregulation, privatisation, and the destruction of trade unionism, which sounds odd as, you know, they betrayed us. But we are seeing a change now in this country. Unions have got decent leaders with working class values, working class roots, and they're starting to stand up and be counted. So hopefully we're seeing a turning of the tide, and hopefully, you know, the IDC will go on and support Dockers around the world as they are doing now, and that the membership will carry on increasing. I won't take any more time up. I'll let the next person speak.
Thank you so much, Doreen. You're always terrific. You really are a firebrand. To acknowledge the presence of the international dock worker here, there's Marco Pietrasanta. Hello, Marco. There's Manuel Lannan from the port of Le Havre, France. Florence. Not sure how to pronounce your last, Touchard, of the European Dock Workers Council. And I want to say that there's been a split in the International Dock Workers Council that we will discuss a little later towards the end of the program. We also have dock workers from the Longshore Union on the West Coast. Joel, thanks, Joel Shore. Michael O'Sullivan, and a couple others who I don't see right now. But our next speaker was one of the militant sacked dock workers, CHOP stewards, Kevin Robo Robinson, who traveled around the world to different countries, Australia. Well, Kevin can name all the countries he traveled to build solidarity for the Liverpool dock workers. Robo, it's all yours.
I sound as if I'm an advert for the, you know, holiday company here. But nevertheless, just kind of say first and foremost, what a, you know, great pleasure it is to speak. I've known Mike Carden virtually all my days on the docks. And I'd just like to send out my heartfelt feelings and thank yous to Mary, Dan, and John for, first of all, putting up with him for so long. What a wonderful human being. From the role, it's hard to say where you'd actually come into this dispute. Myself, personally, is that although I worked down there for 30-odd years, just going on what Doreen said there, the setting up of the Women of the Waterfront, again, it was with Mike Carden that I first discussed it with him. Not because I had this brainwave. The fact was, is that it was about learning lessons from the miners' disputes. Now, the miners, when their wives and partners they supported their loved ones. They developed soup kitchens and so on and so forth, and it galvanized the people together. And I happened to say to Mike Carden on the picket line, Mick, this is going to be a long job, so we need to get the women involved. Yes, he did look at me strange at first, because this is a male-dominated, orientated industry. We never had women down there in any shape or form. The only women that we've seen were the women who worked in the canteens or the women who went aboard the ships. They're the only females that we've seen, right? So there were some people, some men and some women, I should say, who really knew that the wives, sisters and others worked on the docks, but they couldn't tell you exactly what job they did or where they worked on the docks. And some of them didn't know the pointy end of the ship to the blunt end of the ship, because the men, being a so-called macho industry, as already been described, is that we didn't want to sort of bring the pain and the suffering home to our families. We'd have disputes and we'd been on strike for half a day and we'd go home and our wives and families wouldn't even know we'd been in dispute. But that was the industry that we lived in, worked in. And so what we had to do was sort of start to pull things in. Yes, we did have a reputation of being very militant. And why not? Dock workers around the world. That's where international comes into play. But the fact remains is this, is that when it was starting up, I remember saying to Steve Murphy, was the janitor in the union offices. I said, we're going to have to meet the women. We'll have women coming into the building on a Wednesday night. And I announced it at the mass meeting on the Friday, which we had every Friday without that avail. And that was to inform anybody and everyone about our dispute. So when they talk about the fabric of the union, that we, Bill Morris said that we were destroying the fabric of the union, why didn't he send the police into the Jack Jones house or Transport House, as it was called then? They could have, that became our office, because we lived there, we slept there. And so it was only right that we took over the building in one way or another. And so when the women came on board and they weren't accepted, and I'll say this right now, there were certain individuals who were saying, oh no, I'm getting out the house to get away from the women. Well, my answer to them was simply, listen, when the money's rise up, love goes out the window. So you need to stick together. We need to stay together. And that was basically it. So we had the women come in, and we used to meet on a regular basis, a weekly basis of every Wednesday. And I had the task of going along. I would never interfere with them. I helped to set up the structure of their own chair, secretary and treasurer, etc. And then I used to keep them on a weekly basis aware of what was happening. So on the Wednesday evening, I could tell them, just to use Jack Heyman as an example, that Jack Heyman was coming over to visit us next week or next month. Well, that wouldn't get released until the Friday at the mass meeting. But these women would go home on the Wednesday night, cock-a-hoop, telling their partners and loved ones what was happening on the docks before they knew. So it was a way of giving the women their own autonomy, giving them their own, if you like, independence, and having a voice of their own, which they more than adequately dealt with. So it was a case, it was nice, because at least the women were involved at every stage. They knew what was going on, because some men wouldn't tell the wives and partners what was actually going on, simply not because they didn't want to. It was just to keep it away from them, to keep the pressures out of the house and so on and so forth. So that went on. And then obviously the women became their own, and rightly so, in their own rights. So I was, if you like, the meat in the sandwich, where they'd come to me and they'd say, Kevin, what about this? Or I'd go to them and say, listen, we need to do this scab's house, we need to visit it, or we need to go to this company director's house, we need to go and do it. And we used to call it, we never say what we were going to do, we just say, we're going to do some walkies. And they knew then, the women were quite up for that, they knew there was something on the horizon. And the next day, if they'd gone, they'd come and report to me and say, or the men, even their own husbands, and tell me what would happen, what would happened, what the response was. And it wasn't a case of anything spectacular. What it was, they would go into these scabs' houses with their children and their families, and they were singing. They always had a big ghetto blaster, and they played the music, you know, Jimmy Nail, Big River, and songs like that. And it wasn't anything. And what would happen is that the people from the surrounding houses would come out and say, what's going on here? And maybe the police would be called. But what it did, it drew attention to the fact that this is a scab. You might have thought he was going out every morning or whatever, but he was scabbing it. And that was the input of one of the things that the women had. They had that power to do that. And they did it. You know, as I always said through the dispute, give me one woman to five men any day of the week, because they'll get things done. Whereas we'd talk about it, you know, oh, well, I hope it's not raining or stuff like that. The women say, come on, we'll go and do it. Give us it, and so on and so forth. So they, you know, we're developing as part of the spine, if you like, of the docks themselves. So that's my acknowledgement of the women, and I'll always be indebted for them. Now, the other thing was, is that it also opened up the avenue of internationalism. Now, our dispute started in the September 95. In the November, the 24th of November, myself and Terry Teague were sitting in the Maritime Union of Australia's office in Sydney, explaining our case of what was happening. So there we go. We go 12,000 miles to tell another union that we'd never known of before or had any contact with, and they wanted to know about our disputes. And there we were in our own locality. We couldn't even get some of the unions to come on board with us. We couldn't even get our own general executive council online with us. But nevertheless, that's the theme of what internationalism was about. And I say, Jack said it for me. Yes, I was the most traveled internationally, not because I like flying, not because I like duty free, not because I like airports. I had a job of work to do along with whoever came with me. And that was simply, we had to spread the word of what was happening to us, because we were actually corralled in Liverpool, and the union and the dock company were hoping that we'd wilt and we'd perish on the vine, which we weren't prepared to let that happen. And that's why we got up and we went out to, you know, met the likes of Jack and Jim Donovan of the Maritime Union of Australia, and went to New Zealand. I didn't have a choice. I didn't really have a choice. And I was in a fortunate position where I was free. And it wasn't, not, we tried not to take our men away from their families as longer than we need to do. And, you know, I was divorced at the time, so I still, you know, had my kids and I still loved them in every way. But I had to go and do things like this. And in doing so, was making people aware what was happening. And that's where the international level came into play. So we had to harness it all together. And I still believe today, the only way you're going to get anywhere is having that internationalism. You've got, you know, the only place they didn't go was on the West Coast and places like that. But the fact is, that is what makes us today. It's about bonding. I don't need to know, and nobody needs to know, what the understanding of another person's language is. If they're in pain and they're in suffering against an employer or an establishment or a government, then we don't need to know, understand the language. We just act and support. And that's what you call internationalism. By doing that, brings us all together, because unity is strength. And that's what we've got to build on and keep building on. And now, you know, I'd like to think, certainly we have got some leadership now here in the UK with the RMC, which are going through it. And it's the leadership. The people have got to get out of these smoke-filled offices or wherever they are hidden. You've got to come out into the streets and show the people the support. And that's what they're expecting from union leaders now. You can talk for England, you can talk for whoever you want, but it's actually what people want, because they're being starved into submission. And here we are in the fifth richest economy in the world, and we're struggling to put food on the table. They've got children going to school who are being starved. Teachers are bringing food into schools to feed children. What type of society is this? And also talking about here, we've had a beauty contest for the last number of weeks about who's going to be the next Tory leader and next prime minister. And basically what they're trying to carve up is who can do the worst to the people in the nicest possible way. And that's what we're up against. So I'm asking people, no matter where you are, you've got to wake up, because, you know, you will die in more ways than one when there's no support there for you. Yes, we want you all in the unions. Yes, but we want the unions to take the necessary action. We want leadership. And that's what the people are asking for. They're not asking for anything more. They're struggling to get wages, never mind. But one thing that the people have got, because they're at the last tether, is that they've got the will to fight. And let's harness that. And I want to say, I'm finishing, if you don't mind, Jack, I want to thank on behalf of all the sacked Liverpool Dockers and our families, for all the people, wherever they may be, no matter how small or how large it was, whatever help you gave us in any way, we more than appreciate it. I want to say a massive big thank you to you all, and for your families, and to your unions, and we still thank you today, because we're still working in harmony with you. Thanks, Jack.
And thank you, Kevin. I'm going to be the last speaker here, but I just wanted to recognize the presence of Robert Erminger. He was one of the key people involved in the Neptune Jade picket line here in Oakland. And the importance of that strike was that the ship could not get loaded in Oakland. It was forced to find a port on the West Coast. It went up to Vancouver, Canada. They were hit with another picket line up in Canada. No longshoremen worked the ship there. And finally, they decided to go to Yokohama. To their surprise, they were picketed again. The longshoremen in Yokohama refused to unload the ship. That's three consecutive ports. That robo withhold our labor in solidarity with our struggling brothers in Liverpool. And we needed to have more of those kind of actions to prevail.
Will be every docker in every port around the world, so that Mersey Dock and Harbor Company must understand that their cargo may be loaded here by SCAD, but it will not be unloaded in any port in the world.
The only solution is for workers in the various countries to unite, stick together, and back each other's actions up. If capital is going international, then so must labor.
And this is costing the company a lot of money right now. How much is it costing?
Buku bucks. Well, it cost them a lot of money. I don't know the exact amount, but it cost them about $20,000 a day to just be tied up at the wharf. So it cost them money.
You think that this is going to affect Merseyside Dock and Harbor Company if they see this happening here and around the world?
Oh, sure. Definitely. That's how the Mersey Dock Workers Union is going to get their recognition back, as
we unite, internationally unite. How are dock workers here affected by privatization and contracting out?
It would be the same thing. You know, one, if the port of Oakland, say for instance, lease the property out to a private concern, then the private concern would bring in scab labor.
They were picketing because what Thatcher did after that change in the labor laws was to privatize the docks in England. And there was a whole process that repeated itself in port after port. They'd privatize the ports, they'd buy out the older dock workers who were union dock workers, and then they brought in younger casuals, non-union workers. They were paid no benefits, wages were maybe 25% of what they'd been before, and in that process were able to break the unions in port after port. And Liverpool, because of its militant history, was the last port with a collective bargaining agreement intact.
No more, we're mad as hell, won't take it no more. Mad as hell, won't take it no more. We're mad as hell, won't take it no more.
Fired up, won't take it no more. Fired up, won't take
it no more. Woo, 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 woo. Other person that needs to be recognized here is former warehouse workers, Bob Mandel and Stan Woods, who were on board here. Bob was instrumental in proposing the idea to Howard Kaler that we strike against a ship from South Africa in 1984 to protest the apartheid. And thank you, Bob, for on board. So I'm gonna try to finish this up. I had a longer presentation. I'm gonna try to cut it to the core. So in 84, we did have the anti-apartheid action in San Francisco. And about the same time, the Liverpool Dockers were having a strike against a ship from Southwest Africa. About the same time, Liverpool dock workers were striking against a ship from Southwest Africa, which was a colony of South Africa. So our ports have a real similar political tradition. Liverpool is called Red Liverpool. Oakland, San Francisco, we're called the Red and Black branch of the ILWU because of our politics and because of our racial composition. In 2008, the Longshore Union on the West Coast shut down all the ports on May Day to protest the imperialist wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. And that idea came to me from the internationalist group, a revolutionary Marxist group. And I thought that, well, people are always asking the Longshore local in San Francisco and Oakland to do actions. But this is something that would have to be presented to the entire union. And to my surprise, we raised it to the entire union, and that motion, resolution, passed. So in 2008, all the ports were shut down. Essentially, it was only the Longshore Union that took that action, unfortunately. Now, in 2020, what you see here on your screen is the Longshore Union in San Francisco on Juneteenth shut down all the West Coast ports in Canada and the U.S. to protest police terror because of the murder of George Floyd by Minneapolis police. That's the kind of social power that unions have, and that's the tradition not only in Oakland and San Francisco, but also in Liverpool. I wanted to just mention here that of all the different actions that I've taken as a union activist, a class struggle union activist in maritime, the most significant working class action was the Liverpool Dockers, because it coordinated actions with unions internationally. And from the very beginning, the Liverpool dock workers had enlisted the support of the left social democratic Swedish Dockers Union, the CGT Dockers, which were supported by the Communist Party, and La Coordinadora in Spain, which has a tradition coming out of the anarcho-syndicalist movement in that country. So from the very beginning, the kind of support that the Liverpool Dockers got was from the left. And even though the dock workers lost their struggle, what came out of it was, I think Doreen said, was the International Dock Workers Council. But before I get into that, I want to just make a central point here, that what Mike's book was about, over and over again, he makes the point that what is necessary, what is key to all trade unions is never cross a picket line. He says that over and over again. And it's got to be burnt into the minds of trade unionists if they're going to succeed. That's so fundamental. And the second point he makes is that if the right unionists want to go up against the employers for whatever, whether it's a contract, working conditions, they have to first fight their trade union bureaucrats who are collaborating with the employers. That's what happened with the TNG. The union essentially became a tool of the employers, to put it bluntly. They did the dirty work for the employers. Bill Morris refused to support the Liverpool dock workers, even though, as Greg pointed out, the members actually voted to take for the union to take official support to the dock workers. This is the kind of leadership that is present in so much of the trade union movement. And what really needs to be done is to build rank and file caucuses in trade unions that, with the kind of leadership that Mike was proposing. This is the only way forward I see for the trade union movement. I'm sorry, but I'm cutting my remarks very short because I want to be able to, for the people who are participating here, to have a chance to speak. But I will just say that the idea for internationalism came from Jimmy Nolan, who also passed recently. Jimmy Nolan, who was a supporter of the Communist Party, another leftist, came up with this idea because Bill Morris had cut off any kind of support in the UK through the G. He got the Trade Union Congress to give any kind of support to the Liverpool dock workers, and Blair's Labour Party, the New Labour Party, which isn't really a party of the working class at all. This is the kind of battle that the Liverpool Dockers were up against. So I want to just conclude by saying that what's needed is to build rank and file caucuses in the trade unions with a class struggle program that goes up against not only the employers, but is a battle to oust the trade union bureaucrats. That's so fundamental to the trade union movement now. What happened with the IDC? And I have to say that the IDC started out as rather small after the Liverpool Dockers dispute. They were beaten, unfortunately, but the IDC came out of that. And it was a bit of Zola's Germinal, because although the miners were defeated in that book, Germinal ends with the sprouting of new plants in the spring, the new birth of struggle. And so this is what the IDC was seen as coming out of the Liverpool Dockers struggle. We were pretty much all left trade unionists. Now, what's happened is, unfortunately, there's been a split in the IDC. The European sector, most of them, who are, these are the left unions that from the very beginning supported the Liverpool Dockers. They're not satisfied with the transition of a new leadership. Geordi is no longer general coordinator of the IDC. The ILA, the International Longshore Association, which is a business union in the United States, a union in which the president makes $850,000. That's right, $850,000, almost $1 million, is reputed to have a yacht nearly costing as much as he makes. His son, Dennis, is actually the head of the IDC. There's real problems in the ILA. The South and the Gulf ports are predominantly black. The longshoremen in those locals claim that this is an apartheid system in the ILA, because while the majority of the workers longshore do the heavy lifting, the clerks or checkers, the ones that follow the inventory, the cargo on and off the ship, are predominantly white. And from the South Atlantic to the Gulf, the longshore union in the ILA is controlled by the whites. That's why they call it an apartheid system. It's something that's an abomination. It should not exist, just like union officials making nearly $1 million a year. So this, I believe, is part of the problem with the why the European dock workers had a difference with ILA taking over the leadership. And because they refused to pay dues, they've been expelled. And so I'm hoping we can have some robust discussion here, because I think what the Liverpool Dockers did initially was run a principled and very militant struggle. By the way, it wasn't a strike. They were locked out by the employers because they refused to cross a picket line. Nevertheless, they ran a very principled struggle with Mike, Jimmy Nolan, Jimmy Davies in the leadership, people like Robo going around the world garnering support. The problem is that that kind of program of never crossing a picket line, having rank and file control of the union, doesn't exist in the ILA, and they are now in the leadership of the IDC. So I think what needs to be done is to build rank and file caucuses on a class struggle program, not only in the ILA, in the ILWU too, in all unions. We've seen what the Labor Party has done. It's time to recognize that the Labor Party, the British Labor Party, Blair's new Labor Party, is not a party of the working class. And we need to build working class parties, workers' parties that will fight for the interests of the working class. And I want to end with that. And Steve, I'm going to turn it over to you for the discussion period.
Coleman, MMP.
Hi, I want to add to what was just said. I'm a merchant mariner deck officer in MMP, and we were affiliated until 2 years ago as part of the ILA in the AFL-CIO. And because the ILA was poaching jobs, we were under potential sanctions under AFL-CIO until we disaffiliated. And about a month before Richard Trumka passed, he signed a new charter re-recognizing us not affiliated with the ILA because of so many problems that they've caused.
Okay, thank you. Manuel Lennon?
Hello. For those who don't know me, I'm Manuel Lennon, dock workers from Le Havre. I'm union members, and previously we were members of the IDC. Hello. Before. You hear me?
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay.
Hello.
Okay.
Just, everyone else can mute themselves. That would be good.
Can you stop?
I must precise some different things after Jack says some words about the IDC and what makes a difference in the last General Assembly in Lisbon for us, the last General Assembly. The problem was the necessity for us to have someone that represents the basis dock workers. So the dock workers, they need every people that needs to get a mandate in the IDC, in an international union, needs to have a clear mandate from his country first and from his port. And it's not generally a problem with the ILA or not the ILA. It's it's more a thing about the idea of this of a clear mandate from the country. And in you can see in the IDC the presence of people who have not this mandate from their countries. And for us, it is mandatory. This come with the, we do not understand themselves in the last General Assembly. I need to be short, huh? I will not explain everything what happened, but this was the basis of the difference. And we think, on the same way, that we need to change the structure in the European zone to improve the way we are organized. We need to improve our way of doing on the collaboration between unions, where the European Commissions and where the European Social Dialogue Committee, for example, will take more and more importance in the future, and where the European states improve their collaboration to destroy our rights through more and more port packages and things like that. This is a fact that we understand that we need more collaboration, we need to be more organized in the European zones. And we start the process of reorganizing the zone, and we stop to pay directly the IDC with the fee. And we were waiting for the union, for the European zone structure to be ready, and pay our fee to the European zone, then to the European zone, and we write letters about that to the IDC, and we were waiting for this to be ready to pay back our fee to the IDC. The fact is, we were a little long, and at the end, we don't come to an understanding with the two different structures. It's a shame for us, huh, to arrive to this point, to be separated from the IDC. It's a shame. But it is a major force for us, just to understand that the head of the IDC, we need to have a dock workers. We need to have dock workers that represent dock workers and at every level of the social dialogue. And this is it. Huh? If you have more questions, I can answer it if needed. Yeah? Thank you for your time.
Alice?
This is just a poem I wrote at the time I was on the picket line. It's called Solidarity, so it is pro-international. The docks on the Pacific could be quiet as seashells today as work stops for the striking dock workers in Liverpool. The docks could also reverberate like blown conscience across the ocean, rings inside the shells, making one circle, spiraling into one vertex. And a rusty crane slices through the sky, and the birds migrate from one port to another. No one's been talking about Liverpool much. The newspaper owners don't tell you anything much. Closing down the West Coast piers will say a great deal.
Joel?
I was just going to say, Mike Carden had also written another book in his life, a fiction book called The Factory, where he gets into a lot of the issues we're talking about here with rank and file control and taking things to the street a lot. Sometimes the best way to say things is through fiction. And I found it was one of the best books I've ever read. And I encourage people to check that out as well, as the one his son's talking about.
Sandra, you're up.
Well, I wanted to thank people for the event, and I'm really looking forward to reading the book. I'm a supporter of the internationalist group in New York City. And I think, as everybody knows, the struggle in Liverpool, the Liverpool Dockers' fight for the principle, never cross a picket line, was an enormously important and inspiring struggle. And it still continues to be. And this fundamental principle is one that we have to keep fighting for, because lamentably, it is very frequently not put into practice. Sometimes not understood, sometimes understood, but not put into practice. We actually have a button that we've produced, Picket Lines Mean Don't Cross, partly in the wake of a strike here in New York City last year, where a fight to enforce the principle that picket lines mean don't cross proved decisive in the ultimate victory of that strike of student workers in one of the universities here. So I just wanted to make those comments. I know there's a lot more to say, but I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you. I think that the question of internationalism is building united fronts of workers internationally is critical. And I think the lesson of the Liverpool dock worker strike, one of the lessons is that the trade union bureaucracy did not want international action. Today, there's struggles growing all over the world. Namibian miners, their struggles going on internationally, and the unions have to link up, workers have to link up directly internationally in order for these struggles to be successful. And I think that what we're having today, this discussion on the lessons of the Liverpool dock worker strike, is relevant to many struggles that are going on around the world. However, they're not being brought together. And I think we need to bring those together, and we need to build worker-controlled unions that do that. In the United States, I was going to add, we're facing an issue, the rise of fascism in the United States. An attempted coup, an insurrection, and the growing racist fascist movement in the United States. There is no united front of workers in the United States to fight that. There's a war going on in Ukraine. The only action that's been taken against the war is by the Italian workers who took strike action, the logistic workers, C-COBUS. All these issues require, in the case of in the United States with Ukraine, a united action against the war in Ukraine. And unfortunately, the US unions are pro-imperialist. They support imperialism, they support capitalism. And this is a great danger for the working class. And I think that's what we know about the Liverpool Dockers is they were an internationalist union. They did take direct action for the Namibian miners, for workers around the world. And that was one of the reasons the bosses, the capitalists, wanted to crush them. Stan and then John.
Stan Woods, retired ILWU 6 Warehouse Division. To echo a little bit of what Steve said about the war in the Ukraine. So I wanted to ask any of the British sisters and brothers on this call, on this Zoom conference, what would you say the attitude is among rank and file trade unions in Britain towards the war in the Ukraine and the strong subservient stance, both the British government, but also what's his name, Keir Hardie of the Labour Party seems to have towards that war. Is there any sounds rumbling discontent? It's really strange. I was talking to somebody from the Carpenters Union the other day, younger comrade in the Democratic Socialists of America, and he was saying it's really sad in his union, which I don't know how it is in the UK or elsewhere, but the Carpenters Union is a very conservative union in the US. A lot of rank and file carpenters, unfortunately, have conservative views, not all of them. But he said the only people speaking out against the war and the $44 billion aid to the Ukraine, which also goes to the Polish right-wing nationalist government, are Trump supporters within the Carpenters Union, which is a dangerous thing when alt-right starts saying things the left should be saying. So if anybody from the British labor movement on this call have any opinions on what the stance is there anti-war sentiment getting strong within the labor movement in Britain?
Thanks. I can touch a tiny bit on that, Stan. I guess the it's been mentioned already about the British Labour Party's it no longer represents, in my opinion, the working class of the UK. And it comes back to this point that Mike was obsessed with. So I've just found this book on the bookshelf. Mike, one of the things he studied was Robert Michaels and this work, Political Parties, by Robert Michaels, talking about the oligarchic tendencies of trade unions. Now, a lot of, you know, a number of you, so Jack and Sandor mentioned about the kind of significance of action and principles, but also the structural issues within the trade union movement. Now, it's all well and good that Liverpool Dockers having phenomenal international support, but ultimately they were still failed by the bureaucratic structures of the trade union. And we saw a similar thing kind of more recently in the UK Labour Party when a socialist was by chance elected as the leader. So Jeremy Corbyn was elected by the overwhelmingly twice by the membership as the leader of the Labour Party. And he was thwarted again by the internal structures and the bureaucracy of the of that organization. So I think in terms of what action should be called for or what action we can perhaps work towards, I think it's to use collective power to change structures. And because without that, Manuel, you mentioned this about structural changes and the importance of that. Without that, I don't think we can win because everything's stacked against you. You might have international support, you might
shut things down. Okay, Chan said.
You might shut things down, you might have a short-term impact, but unless the structures are fundamentally changed to represent workers at the, you know, at every level. And Mike argued that should be done always through elected positions. No one should be, there shouldn't be this officer class of a union that get paid 3, 4, 5 times the salary of their members, are in stable work. And it's this professionalization of the union that's part of the problem. So instead we need rank and file led organizations. And perhaps that's a productive place that our respective struggles can challenge the organizations that are supposed to represent us.
Thank you. I mean, if you think the UK, the TUC and the unions in Britain are conservative, I mean, the AFL-CIO prevented a resolution from coming to the floor calling for a general strike against a coup or insurrection. They wouldn't even have a discussion on it. They refused to have a resolution on the threat of fascism and fighting fascism. So I do know the TUC did call a mass march, 80,000. Against the attacks. And I think that the conditions in Britain are leading possibly to a general strike. In the United States, the AFL-CIO supports the war and they don't want any democracy and they don't want any mass mobilization of labor, even in a protest march. Okay, Bob and then Greg.
I learned something unexpectedly this morning. The California Teachers Association, which is 300,000 strong, is having its summer institute, which is where it ostensibly trains people. And it devoted a part of its presentation yesterday to the positive role unions played in bringing down the Soviet Union, and specifically in Poland. And then went into a whole series of anti-communist tropes. And it really struck me, since there's discussion here about the labor bureaucracy, why in the middle of the summer of 2022 would they be talking about how good it was that the Soviet Union was destroyed. And it occurred to me that while the strike wave in the United States is still many, and while the organizing of Amazon at Staten Island is only a first step, and the Starbucks organizing and stuff like that is still only a first step, that maybe the labor bureaucracy in this country is concerned enough, and the Democrats can see the sharpening of class antagonisms, that they're moving preemptively to choke off. They see the development of democratic socialists of America. They see AOC getting elected. And even though those are not revolutionary tendencies in the left yet, much less in the labor movement, to see a major union bureaucracy renewing conscious anti-communism can't be an accident.
Okay, thank you. Greg?
Yeah, I'd really like to bring people back to the point I tried to bring out at the end of what I said about the book. You see, Mike didn't simply see this as rank and file caucuses or left caucuses fighting for power in the union. He actually said the problem is at the level of the membership. And that is what I think. I think that Liverpool was an exceptional situation in which you had a very highly educated membership with a tremendous determination to understand what was going on in their own situation and also looking out to the rest of the class. In order to be able to challenge the bureaucracy effectively in the TNG, that would have to have been going on throughout the union. There would have had to have been dozens and dozens of industries or of workplaces, of branches that were at the level that Liverpool was at, in order to be able to take on this betrayal of the General Executive Council. So I think that seeing this in electoral terms of how do we, you know, kick out this set of bureaucrats and put another set of people in is to underestimate the depth of what the problem really is. It doesn't simply come down to who has been elected. It comes down to what their relationship with the base is. And that comes down to how interested and willing the base membership is to actually get involved at the level that Liverpool was. You know, you had these mass meetings of 500 people at which, you know, more or less everybody in the room knew what was going on and wanted to know what was going on. So I'd really like, even if we run out of time for the discussion, I'd really like to re-stress that. That is what Mike was talking about, and that's also what I think. On the Ukraine thing, all I want to say is this. You cannot start an analysis of this question merely by looking at what you think of US imperialism and putting a minus sign in front of that. You also have to look at what actually happened in Ukraine and what Russia did. The US didn't force them to invade Ukraine, they did it. And so you have to start from that in order to understand this. But I don't want to kill this conversation by turning it into a conversation about Ukraine. We have something quite important here and unique with the Liverpool Dockers dispute, and let's keep on that.
And one thing that has been left out of this discussion is the situation in the ILWU, whose contract expired July 1st, and the companies want to impose technology that would lead to the loss of jobs And basically the ILWU national leadership has refused to inform the members what's going on. There's secret negotiations, and they're working with the Biden and the Labor Secretary, Marty Walsh, to make sure there's no strike. So this whole issue of democracy again raises itself in the negotiations, because the negotiations are being kept secret from their members, and a lot of members are angry. I put up in the chat a report by Trent Willis, the past president of the ILWU, about the fact that members are unhappy, but the only way that they're going to get any action is by taking power on the job. And that is really the issue. If you don't use your power that you have on the job, you're not going to be able to challenge the boss and the capitalists. So that's what's part of what's going on in the ILWU. Ricardo.
Well, since it was mentioned the war in the Ukraine, and somebody blamed one side, we definitely, as workers and revolutionaries, we have to address this issue. I mean, the NATO imperialists, they did provoke this war. Actually, the NATO imperialists have been intervening in Ukraine since the fall of the Soviet Union. And they sent a functionary within the American embassy to be the chief finance officer. Her name is Natalie Jaresko. And she led a program of privatization of the Ukrainian economy at the behest of the U.S. and the European Bank of Reconstruction. Actually, she was put in charge of a U.S. government task force in the embassy in the Ukraine, and forced Ukraine to get loans from the IMF to privatize the Ukrainian economy. And in the 2014 coup, the United States imposed this very same person as the Minister of Finance of Ukraine to further privatize more of the Ukrainian economy and to further indebt the Ukraine on the hands of United States and European vulture funds, banks, and another actually big loan was forced to be made from the IMF to privatize more the Ukrainian economy. And actually, I mean, if the Chancellor of Germany, he admitted that they wanted, to confront Russia on this issue. And that is a fact. And we're not going to give any support to the capitalist Russian regime, because, the Russian regime is a capitalist country. So we call for a revolutionary defeat on all sides. And we call for the Ukrainian, Russian, and NATO and NATO countries' working classes to overthrow these capitalist governments. And ever since the invasion of the Ukraine, the NATO imperialists have been arming to the tooth. The Ukraine, they have been testing weaponry. And the latest that has been revealed by Canadian and American newspapers is that the United States have put military advisors to train the Ukrainian army right there in the Ukraine, and also Canadian and other NATO countries have put a CIA paramilitary. I mean, the United States refused to deny that they have put CIA paramilitaries on the ground, plus the special forces to train the Ukrainian military. So, this is not a question of, putting the bad or, it is that in this war, the imperialist powers have a bloody hand on it. And we want to call for NATO to get out of the Ukraine and, start exploiting the Ukraine. And started, exploring their own work, the European capitalists, to stop exploiting their own working classes. So, for revolutionary defeat on all sides. And also, we say one thing: in the Donbas and in this majority Russian-speaking regions, if they want to secede from the Ukraine, they have the right to do so. And if, you know, if fascists get killed over there, we shed no tears about it. That's what I want to say. And anybody that sides with NATO is a traitor.
Oh, Ralph?
Yeah, just I'm also a supporter of the IG in Germany. I just wanted to say that for us, the main enemy is actually at home. It's our imperialists. And this war in the Ukraine is being beefed up and was provoked by especially NATO and guided by the US. And they wanted to keep Russia out, Germany down and themselves in, and that's what they have so far achieved. Biden said before the war had started, he said this Nord Stream pipeline is not going to happen. And people asked him, well, how do you know how? And he said, we have the means. And that's what they did there. They armed the military, the Ukrainian military at the front line, at the contact lines in eastern Ukraine. And they were obviously planning to attack the eastern regions there and to take them back. And they have been doing this for basically, they have, they said it just a few days ago. They said, we have been preparing for this since 2014. They have been preparing this war. And they want, in the end, they want to get onto China. So China is a deformed worker state, which we defend. So we have to really see this is an imperialist provoked war, and the main enemy for us here in the imperialist centers is our bourgeoisie. So it's urgently posed for the working class to stop these military, the weapon transports into the Ukraine, which, where does it end? World War? It's really so important. And the Italian workers have been in the forefront, the first ones to do these actions to stop these weapons, and now they are under attack. They have arrested eight trade unionists in the base, from the base trade unions, and accused them for their trade union and class struggle work from 2014 or something back, and called that they are that they were building a terrorist organization. So it's also a very important issue that the working class, the trade unions, have to take up.
Here, Jameson.
A bit more towards Liverpool Docks. Oh yeah, I'm a master's student at Goldsmiths studying theories of workers' power, and I've been reading Mike's book, which I thought was very good. And yeah, in the last few chapters, he touched upon some of the organising which is happening now in Liverpool. But I wondered if anyone on the panel could expand a bit on how the strike in the late 90s has affected organising today, and like kind of what the level of union membership is like at Liverpool Docks currently, or yeah, like the legacy in Liverpool of the strike in the 90s. I wonder if anyone had any information on that.
Would anyone from Liverpool like to speak to that on the panel about the effect of the Liverpool struggle on organizing today?
I can, but I'll leave it to either Kevin or Doreen if they want to speak to it, but if not, I will.
I know that John Lynch, who's one of the leaders of the trade union now on the Liverpool Docks, former dock workers, so Terry Teague and Tony Nelson, and possibly, I'm not sure, Kevin, if you've been involved in that as well, trying to rebuild the union membership on the docks with the kind of new cohort who are there today. The union membership now, I believe, is up to in the 90%. So it really has come a long way, and it's been very much a kind of a rebuilding of a rank and file organization.
Technology gone berserk. But yeah, in answer to the question, you just got to, if we may just look back at it, when we left, when did the, no people that were sacked were actually taken back on the docks, right? They may have gone back in different guises, but John's rightly saying that what the union again thought that when the strike was over, that they would just sort of brush it all aside and we'd carry on as business as usual. And what basically happened, and it took a good hard lesson for them to learn, and it was only through having conversations with the likes of Len McCluskey and likes of Terry and Tony and others, that they realized that what was happening, what they couldn't understand, the union, this is how blind they were to it. They just thought the strike finished in 98 and then it was, we'll start as business as usual. And what happened is that they, as long as they were in the union, they were quite happy with that. Even though all the work on labor-wise was casual labor, agency labor that was coming into the docks. Now, they put different full-time officers in there. My analogy is you rather ask the mechanic to fix your car than ask the milkman. And that, in essence, was what they were trying to do. They were putting people in there just to block the gap. And what we said to Lenny at the time, the reason why, Lenny, because he says, I'm going all around this country and I'm finding that the ports are being organized, and yet here's my own port, Liverpool, not organized. And the simple answer was, Lenny, because the wrong people are going in there. For example, if you, an officer who went into the port of Liverpool, and if I was, sadly, a manager in there, my first question would be to the officer, and what part of the dock industry did you come from? Because he never, there was nobody dock officers going into there because they weren't, they had none. So then that's where Terry and Tony and came into the horizon, and they got in there. They started to organize them. They got the union bedded in. They had a structure in there. John Lynch became the coordinator in there. And so there, and from there on in, it came from having casual labor where the Peel ports, who are the people who own the ports, is that they have now taken that casual labor in-house. So they got decent wages. I don't know how decent, I'll qualify that. It's just about that. They've got better wages and conditions that they had, and therefore they built, and now all the union and everything appertaining to C4 docks is unionized. That wouldn't have happened. That wouldn't have happened. So on the plus side of it, it is unionized, and it is, you know, sort of solid in a way. And they're reaching out. There's a dispute on the horizon now in the port of Liverpool. And I don't know the semantics of it, but I believe that, you know, the fluff and the feathers, and they're going to have a go, and good luck to them. And the old adage, if you don't fight, you lose. If you do fight, you can win. So that's all we can say to people who are in struggle everywhere and anywhere. Have a go. And at least you can say to your family and everybody that you had a go, and you'll never be criticized for having a go, but you will be criticized for
for not having a go. So stand up and fight.
This is a real important contribution. I hope that we were able to get this out broadly so working people around the world can learn the lessons of this important work, and we can build greater international working class solidarity and as an example of the learning from the lessons of the Liverpool dock workers. So I want to thank all of you for joining. Solidarity, brothers and sisters.
United we're as strong as a mountain. United we're as deep as the sea. Stand together, shoulder to shoulder, sisters and brothers, united and free.